Hello again, and so now this is me leaving El Baggio. As you can see, it's like it's pretty rudimentary stuff as far as the way people live. You can see some people just sitting there. So I left pretty early in the morning. I didn't have a long ride day today, even though it says 7 hours or five or six hours on the 5 hours I think on the river. It actually took me seven because the river app crashed at one stage. But my first point of call was to go to a place called La Bufadora, and that's it's quite famous for a geyser. It's a marine geyser, like a blowhole. There you can see the little town there, and the town is coming. It's actually pretty small, but there's a really lovely little market which was getting set up when I got there. The roads were so-so. A little bit rough. You'll find the roads in Central and South America where the trucks go, they get ruined pretty quickly. I mean, you can see sometimes you have two lanes and the trucks by law have to be in the right lane, and the road will be relatively new on your side and then just completely torn apart on the truck side, and then some trucks try to get into the other lane and stuff like that. They actually get pulled over and fined if they do. But it's pretty rough riding for them. So I just took my time. It was really scenic, You can see on the right there. There's some salmon farms and stuff like that. I sped that a little bit up. But it's pretty cool. Some little seaside villages and stuff like that. Not a lot of traffic the whole day. I had it pretty easy. You just got to be a little bit careful with a bit of oil on the road from time to time, and just make sure you're always concentrating. I mean, there's nothing that's more fun than riding around twisties and stuff like that, and I really enjoyed it. And so I had to basically go about 45 minutes across to La Bufadora, and then I had to go back up to Ensenada basically. Basically because there's not many options as far as roads go, and you'll find that when you get to Baja you can go right off road, but I didn't yet have a map, any of the maps to do that. I ended up doing that on the next trip. I got some maps in San Felipe and I was able to do a couple hundred or so miles off road. But as you can see now, I'm coming into La Bufadora. I'm going to say it correctly. Hang on a sec. This is pathetic. La Bufadora. I mean, how hard's that? That's ridiculous. And there's like quite a few restaurants. I was pretty hungry, and there was quite a few restaurants on the way, but they're all closed. It was pretty early in the morning. Again, I had a beautiful day to ride, and I was really relaxed because I had two nights near Ensenada and up El Baggio, and the hotel I stayed at was cheap and was beautiful, and I pretty much had the whole place to myself, so it was pretty cool, and I really enjoyed it there. And if I didn't have to work, and I wanted to get moving pretty quickly, so because I had certain places I really wanted to see. And you'll find that along the way, you can see those little huts on the right hand side there. You'll see that a lot through Central America, and some of them are a bit more organized than others. Those little islands out there are just bird shit all over them. So they look pretty cool, but apparently when you get out close to them, they stink pretty badly. I had some places I really wanted to get to, so. So this trip I took in here, and then I stopped for a while, had a little bite to eat. There was just one stall open in town because they were all setting up in the morning for the markets, but I can imagine that's a pretty cool little place with all the markets running. And I was able to get a bit of breakfast and then basically had a walk around the blowhole, which is pretty incredible. It's pretty cool. But this time of year, even though it's hot and warm and all that, it's still hot and warm in North America, so not many people travel down here during this year. So it's a quiet time of year here, which is great. It was great for me anyway. The town, I think, is around about 4,000 or 5,000 people. As you can see, as you on the right there, you can see the town. It looked like a pretty cool place. You'll find the really good tourist areas are a lot cleaner than the rest of it. There's a bit of a picture in of the area with the blowhole and all that sort of stuff. It's a pretty cool little area, but you'll find that there's still rubbish on the side of the road and all that sort of stuff. You can't really see it that well from here. Oxo, there are all the chains, and here I come into the little market area. So this is the main part of town. As you can see, it's pretty early in the morning and all the stalls are pretty much closed. But on the way back, there was a lot more people setting up. It was still pretty barren. But this is where you get your good food from, because most of their trade, especially in the smaller towns that aren't tourist towns, most of the trade is from is locals. So if you're going to be successful and going to be a local little eatery along the side of the road, you're going to have to be pretty good food. And I found that all the way through, that it was always fantastic, the food. I spent probably about half an hour, three quarters of an hour here once I got settled in, and I really enjoyed it. But the problem is I had to go back up, so I had to go back up to Ensenada and then across. I'm trying to work out what I'm going to do here. This guy's waving me down here. Just gave him a few dollars to look after me. I just parked on the side there and then just walked back up and had a bite to eat, and the local told me where I can go to the blowhole. I really liked, these days where you've only got 5 or 6 hours to ride, you can just really take your time, and you can stop off plenty of times, and they're my favorite days where you don't have like a big amount of miles to do. I did the boring roads when I knew that they were going to be boring roads. I did a chunk of miles. But when it was more scenic, I basically made sure that I did. I made sure I did a lot less miles. I spent a bit of time here. I've always got little notes to myself. I don't know what I've got written on there. From here, I walked up the hill, got some breakfast, had a little bit of a chat with a couple of people. My Spanish was, which was terrible even at the end, was not too flash at the start, I can guarantee you. I knew a bit. I did all this work. There's an app called Duolingo. And I did like months of learning on that, and I picked up quite a few words, but once people started talking to you, it was like 100 miles an hour, and it was near impossible to work out what they were saying. So I was getting maybe one word in every sentence they were talking to me with, so it became a bit of a nightmare for me at the beginning. But if you target young people and you start chatting to younger people, a lot of them will actually know a little bit of English, or some of them, fluent in English. So it was never so much of a problem. It probably hindered me a little bit in learning more. And one of the guys I traveled with, Chris, was a lot more advanced by the time we met up in Santiago. He was a lot more advanced in with his Spanish than what I was, and there was other guys as well that knew as little as what I did, even at the end. So it's just, I think some brains are built for it, especially if you've learned another language as a child. It's a lot easier to learn a new language. Here's some shots I took along the way there. I don't know why this video is here, but That was going back up. I thought I had a few more shots here. These are just shots along the way. I think there was a couple of other riders coming past, and I took a little video of them as they flew past me. But yeah, like in Baja, I hardly saw any adventure riders. That GoPro pole there, it's actually a GoPro pole, but I've adjusted for my 360 camera. So this wouldn't be long after I left La Bufadora, because you can see there I've got the 360 camera going. It's a really cool camera. It's called the Samsung Gear 360, and there's a new version coming out soon. And even the old version, I just loved it because it was just so simple to shoot. You could just do like a 2 minute video would be about 1 gigabyte at the full 4K. But you can edit it on the screen, the start and the finish, and then just publish it, just send it to YouTube or Facebook automatically. They are big file sizes, but you know, if you've got good internet, they're fine. But I just thought it was such an easy thing. I wish, you know, I've got a Drift Ghost S on my helmet, and it's fine, and this is where this footage is coming from. However, you know, you just got to do a lot of work their app for Drift is terrible, but I mean, it's no worse than GoPro's app, or it's actually worse than GoPro app because you can't really do anything. But the GoPro app, from my perspective, for so many years was just a bunch of crap. And now they've got a service, you know, they want you to pay money, you know, so I'm not that keen on the GoPros anymore. But the Drift have got a new camera, a 4K camera coming out. I hope they have the lower res versions with really high frame rates, because that's what makes it a great camera. Because I could shoot maybe 20 minutes and it'd only be, you know, maybe a gigabyte file size. You know, the file sizes were pretty good. And that makes a big difference, especially when you're traveling to countries that the internet is not the strongest suit. You know, of the infrastructure of a company, it's great to have. It's good to have smaller file size if you want to upload it. But after Baja, and I went across to Mexico, basically that's why I'm doing all the videos now, is because there was just so few opportunities to actually do some uploads. The second time I did uploads was in Santiago. I got an Airbnb, and they advertised in the title that they had 100 megabyte internet connection. And so I snapped that one up pretty quick. And it was a good apartment too, a really nice guy. And Chris came and stayed a couple of nights there with me as well. Here's this is a group going for a ride, saying hello. So I met a few of those sort of people. So they fly in and they'd rent the bikes for a day and then they'd go back out. So I met a few of those sort of people, but not many. I didn't meet anyone in Baja, even. I met a guy at the La Paz ferry terminal who was going to Mexico, really nice guy, but the other guys I met were all Harley riders, you know, and Mazatlan is a pretty popular spot for the Harley riders. But this was a nice ride today, you know, a lot of twisties through the mountains. I think I've got up to about 1,200 metres, you know, about 4,000 feet. So it's an ever-changing landscape, and then basically through the middle it got a little bit boring. And then basically once I headed towards the coast again and got to like Playa Hawaii and San Felipe, it got pretty cool again. Got a little bit interesting. But right now I'm just getting used to riding the longer days, and having a 5-6-7 hour day is, you know, it was pretty cool for me. Because I knew I was going to get there at a good time, and I didn't have to rush, so I could stop off at a few places. Unfortunately, in Mexico and a few of the other countries, all the best views, there's nowhere really to stop. So you come around a corner and you have an amazing view, but there's nowhere to stop on the road. On the roadside, it's too dangerous because there's a lot of trucks and all that sort of stuff. So that's what's disappointing. It'd be great if those countries started thinking, oh, well, there's some really good views to be had here on this corner, so we'll extend the corner out so people can park a car and take a photo. And as you got into Chile and Argentina, they had like little, you know, 1 kilometer with a camera thing saying it's good. So that was pretty cool when that happened, because you knew where you can get a good shot. But in through Mexico and that, with some amazing views, there was just nowhere to stop. Baja is full of mountains, this is one of the plains I was on, and you're up pretty high. It's actually pretty cold once you get up high and you go through the high plains. It's still pretty interesting. Had no problems with gas stations, even though it's pretty desolate. This is where my final stop is, actually, in San Felipe. Plenty of gas stations. I never had a problem through all of Mexico, and even Baja didn't have any issues with gas. Although you've really got to tip the guys that give you the gas, even though they don't say you should. Some of the more budget guys didn't tip them, but you know, they make most of their money from the tips. So as I found out once I got to La Paz and I met a guy named Leo at Leo's Baja Oasis. So as you can see, you sort of see a truck. You know, there was some little stops along the way, but they were never in places you wanted to stop. You know, they were always just in pretty boring sort of areas. So a little bit disappointing with that. I didn't have too much trouble here. There was one day in Baja, I had a guy overtake me on a blind corner, and a car was coming the other way, and that was just crazy. I don't know if I got that on video, but it won't be on today's video. That was just insanity. Oh, I'm taking a friggin' photo, hands free. So actually, when you get a bit bored, you actually do that. You play like I was. I put my arms out and try to steer the bike with my arms, with the wind in my arms, like turning my hands. It actually works, you know. Subtly, you wouldn't be able to do a decent corner with it. You end up playing games, and you know, I had some music I'd have on, and not that you want to know what sort of music I have, but it's all pretty old stuff. And then I've got some audio books. Like, one of my favourite audio books is Bill Bryson's A History of Nearly Everything, which is goes for ages, but I could listen to them over and over again all the time. They're really cool. And I had some Ricky Gervais podcasts that I had. So if I got a bit bored, I'd listen to a bit of that. The only thing is you have to have the visor down so you can actually hear it. As you can see right now, I've got the visor up. It's not really that safe to do it, especially if you've got cars coming past you, but I just turned my head the other way whenever a truck was passing or a car. I pounded out about 200 and something miles today, but well, it was just a nice day, nice day's riding. I had a couple of tough days ahead of me. One was 100 or so miles on pretty tough dirt, dirt's tough anyway. I mean, if you're going to be riding for 100 miles on dirt, you're going to be pretty tired, because you've got to concentrate the whole time, and there's a lot of you're maneuvering your body up on the pegs and the stuff like that. It's a place I stayed at, was okay, and this is coming into San Felipe. You've always got to be, one thing I always say is that when you, at the end of your ride, you start and end of your ride, more so the end of your ride, you've got to be really alert. Because when you come into towns, there's usually people in a rush, even in small towns like this. And San Felipe, it's not that small, but it's one of the major sort of towns. But you've got to keep your wits about you. You've finished your ride, you're all relaxed, you can't wait to get that beer in your gut. And some food, and you can lose a little bit of concentration, and it's not, you know, nearly all the accidents I saw were in and around towns along the way, and a couple of deaths along the way that I saw were in and around towns, and you know, just people not concentrating. One was a slippery road, the other one was just a poor kid on a motorcycle. Well, he's a poor kid because he died, but he was stupid. He was sitting right behind a truck and then just ducked his head out, ducked the whole bike out, little moped, out from behind the truck, and there was no room. The bus just went straight through, collected him. So this was actually quite pretty, this place here. a nice little boardwalk area, and I just did a couple of laps around here, and then until I found a spot to have some tucker, and then from there I basically just headed to my hotel, and it was a pretty basic sort of place that I was staying in, and got ready for the following day's ride. So I stayed around the city area for about 2 hours, and had a little bit of a look around. I was deciding whether to have something here or go back all the way, and I decided to go back all the way at the start of it, at the start of the boardwalk, and have a look from there. San Felipe is a pretty cool little spot, and definitely, I mean, you've pretty much got to visit it, really, unless you're going breezing past, because there's not many towns along the way, and you'll find that through most of the central Baja. It's pretty desolate, and you end up finding that any town you just basically end up wanting to stop in. But everything was going well. The bike was performing well, and I never didn't have any issues with fuel up to this stage, and with the gas quality, you'll find that you get 98, 92. You just got to watch the ethanol mix. That's all. You know, especially if you've got a modern bike, you want to make sure the ethanol mix is pretty low, less than 10% all the time. Anything more than that, you know, I had issues, and sometimes you just didn't have a choice. You had to just go with it. And by the end of my trip, my fuel pump was pretty much screwed. And needs to be replaced. But so I basically spent the last couple of hours here, then headed to the hotel, got unpacked, got my gear all together. I just go through the same routine every time. I get home, I get back there, I've got like an anchor powerhouse, I plug it all in, and then I charge all my devices, then I download, go for a walk for an hour or two, come back, everything's charged, download everything, and I'm away. All right, guys, well, thanks very much, and there's a nice little sign, San Felipe, and we'll chat again soon. Questions or comments below.